From the JAMA Network, this is the JAMA Medical News Podcast, discussing timely topics in clinical medicine, biomedical sciences, public health, and health policy featured in the medical news section of JAMA.
This is Jennifer Abbasi for JAMA Medical News. My guest today is Dr. Felix Mahfoud, who will be sharing clinical research highlights from the European Society of Cardiology Congress, ESC's annual flagship meeting that was held recently in Madrid. Dr. Mahfoud serves on ESC's board and chairs its communication committee. He's a professor of cardiology at the University of Basel in Switzerland and chairman of the Department of Cardiology at University Hospital Basel. Welcome, Dr. Mahfoud.
Hello.
This year's ESC Congress had an incredible 33,000 attendees from 169 countries, and researchers from more than 100 countries presented their work. We're going to talk about several of those studies that have the potential to impact patient care, as well as a new consensus statement on mental health conditions and cardiovascular disease. So let's get to it. We'll start with research that was simultaneously published in JAMA. This study looked at outcomes with the GLP-1 drugs semaglutide and tirzepatide in patients with type 2 diabetes and obesity-related heart failure with preserved ejection fraction. The study compared heart failure hospitalizations and all-cause mortality in patients who received either these drugs, Ozempic and Mounjaro, or the glucose-lowering drug sitagliptin as a placebo proxy. So what did we learn?
This is indeed a very important study because we know that heart failure with preserved ejection fraction is a major cause of hospitalization and is often occurring in patients with cardiometabolic comorbidities such as obesity and type 2 diabetes. And in this analysis that encompasses several randomized controlled trials, it's a kind of meta-analysis, it was nicely shown that in 58,000 patients that were either treated with semaglutide or tirzepatide or sitagliptin, that indeed those patients who were treated with semaglutide or tirzepatide had a significantly and substantially lower risk of the primary endpoint that was, as you mentioned, heart failure hospitalization or death. So this is reassuring. It shows that in this large group of patients, in this large cohort that was included in this analysis, indeed, patients with cardiometabolic HFpEF had significantly lower risks of the composite of heart failure hospitalization and all-cause mortality if they were treated with semaglutide and tirzepatide.
The researchers also did a head-to-head comparison of the two GLP-1 drugs and found no meaningful difference between them on these outcomes. So what's your takeaway from this study?
That is interesting. I mean, the study was not powered for the comparison, nor was it powered for the overall outcome, right? This is a kind of meta-analysis. But I was a bit surprised to see this because we have seen and we have learned by other studies that with tirzepatide, the weight reduction is larger or higher as compared to semaglutide. But that obviously is not translating into a difference in risk reduction when it comes to the endpoint that was investigated here. And again, that was the composite of hospitalization for heart failure and all-cause mortality.
And so what's the takeaway for clinicians overall from this study?
I think this study confirms what we have seen in other studies, that indeed in patients with HFpEF associated with obesity and diabetes type 2, by implementing a treatment that contains either a GLP-1 receptor agonist, such as semaglutide, or a GIP agonist in addition, such as tirzepatide, there's not only a weight reduction observed, but also a significant reduction in a heart cardiovascular outcome, which is a hospitalization for heart failure and all-cause mortality observed. So this is reassuring and underpins the importance of these drugs in the treatment of patients with cardiometabolic diseases, including patients with HFpEF.
All right, thank you. Next, let's discuss a pair of studies that investigated a standard treatment, which is the use of beta blockers after MI. Now, I've been following this question since 2018 when I first wrote about it for JAMA. The issue is that many of the trials for post-MI beta blockers were conducted before contemporary procedures and drugs came along. So does every patient who has an MI today really need them? The two studies presented at the Congress this year looked at this question in patients who did not have heart failure or who had a preserved or mildly reduced left ventricular ejection fraction. What did these studies find?
So this is really an ongoing controversy in cardiology care, right? As you mentioned, we have old data supporting the use of beta blockers in patients post-myocardial infarction, but these studies were carried out before contemporary revascularization was implemented. And these days, most of the patients that are treated receive immediate and complete revascularization, either at the initial presentation or as a staged procedure. But most of the patients that we see are completely revascularized at follow-up. And, you know, the two studies that were presented at ESC, one from Spain and one from Denmark and Norway, investigated, as you said, pretty much the same patient population. Patients with myocardial infarction, but with an ejection fraction of above 40%. And they were randomized to receive long-term beta blocker therapy or not. And the outcomes were very different, right? In one study, the Bitami-Denblock study, that included 5,500 patients, there was a significant reduction observed in those patients who were treated with beta blockers. So they had a significantly lower risk of the composite endpoint, which was death or major adverse cardiovascular event through follow-up, of 15%. So this study indeed showed that it was beneficial, or that the initiation of beta blocker therapy post-myocardial infarction in these patients was beneficial and associated with lower events. The other study, the REBOOT study, investigated the same patient population in Spain. 4,243 patients were randomly assigned to receive beta blocker or no beta blocker therapy. And in this study, during follow-up, there was no significant difference observed between the two groups. And the major endpoint here was death, reinfarction, or hospitalization for heart failure. And again, the event rates were pretty comparable between the two groups.
So, where does that leave us?
Yeah, you know, it's interesting to see that these two studies with very different outcomes were presented during the same session at ESC Congress and published in the same issue of the New England Journal of Medicine, and have very different outcomes. I think, you know, and in the same session, there was also a meta-analysis presented that included from several randomized controlled trials, including those that we just discussed, patients with an ejection fraction of 41 to 49. And in that cohort of patients, it's pretty clear that across studies, there was a benefit observed in those patients who were treated with beta blockers. So I guess in patients with mildly reduced ejection fraction, 41 to 49, beta blockers remain a therapy of choice. In patients above 50, I think it's a bit unclear on whether these patients should be prescribed to beta blockers or not. I'm more in the group of physicians who believe that probably in patients with an ejection fraction of above 50%, if there is no other indication for beta blocker therapy, may it be angina or may it be arrhythmias or may it be high blood pressure, that in those patients purely for the indication of post-myocardial infarction, beta blockers are not necessarily needed because we have evidence now supporting that indeed in those patients, ejection fraction is above 50%, is not associated with reductions in heart outcomes.
Okay, that's helpful. Thank you. Continuing with the topic of secondary prevention, the next study we'll discuss compared clopidogrel and aspirin for secondary prevention of coronary artery disease, including both acute and chronic presentations. And this was a systematic review and individual patient data meta-analysis. Tell us why this study is important and what it found.
In the cardiology community, there is a debate ongoing on whether long-term therapy, single antiplatelet therapy, long-term therapy in coronary artery disease should be clopidogrel or aspirin. And since a couple of years, there is evidence aggregating that indeed clopidogrel may be the better long-term partner in CAD care. So during the ESC Congress and simultaneously published in The Lancet, a meta-analysis, an independent patient data meta-analysis was presented that comprised data from seven randomized controlled trials, including almost 29,000 patients with a median follow-up of 2.3 years. And the investigators found that at 5 years, MACE was significantly less common in patients treated with clopidogrel as compared to patients treated with aspirin. And the difference was statistically significant, and the risk reduction was 14%. There was no significant difference observed in rates of mortality and major bleeding between the two groups, one again treated with clopidogrel and one treated with aspirin. And I think that these findings indeed add to the growing body of evidence indicating that clopidogrel monotherapy is indeed better as compared to aspirin monotherapy for prevention of major cardiovascular adverse events and is not associated with an increased risk of bleeding. And I'm sure that these findings will inform guideline committees around the world and may indeed lead to new guideline recommendations on the preferential use of clopidogrel over aspirin for secondary prevention in patients with established coronary artery disease.
Now, would that be a major change for clinicians and patients? I mean, I wonder if, you know, are there benefits to aspirin just being an over-the-counter drug?
That's a very good question and a valid point, right? One has to highlight, though, that clopidogrel is a generic drug and is widely available in various geographies in the world. It's cheap, too. And it shows, again, that MACE rates are lower, right? And formerly, it was argued that, yes, MACE may be lower with clopidogrel, but we're buying that for a higher rate of major bleeding and then also probably mortality. And this is an analysis here on a large database indicating that this is not the case. So it's safe and effective. And I think that that should trigger indeed a change in clinical practice. Yes.
Okay. Let's shift gears now and talk about what seems to be a growing area of interest, which is protective associations that have been emerging with the shingles vaccine. JAMA Medical News has written about a potential protective role of the shingles vaccine against dementia. At ESC Congress, researchers presented data on the shingles vaccine and heart attack and stroke. So tell us about this.
This is indeed another interesting systematic review and meta-analysis that has shown that indeed patients who received a vaccine against herpes zoster to prevent shingle had a statistically significant lower risk of heart attack and stroke. And this is to some extent new. We have learned by other trials that vaccination in general may be associated with lower major adverse cardiovascular event risk. And this large meta-analysis presented at ESC supports this now in a large cohort of patients that were included in over 19 studies conducted around the world. And, you know, I think that highlights once more that vaccination is important, not only for prevention of infection, but also and potentially to reduce cardiovascular risk.
Do we have any sense of why there may be a protective role of the shingles vaccine?
That's a very good question. This has not been prospectively tested in a controlled study, but there are ideas that, you know, inflammation, of course, is associated with the cardiovascular events. We have learned that in high inflammatory states, there is a higher risk of stroke and heart attacks. Also, post-infection, we do see higher rates of stroke and heart attacks. So the question is, can you reduce that by preventing the development of the infection and the disease? And obviously, that's the case. And that is the general hypothesis that we reduce and lower mortality and thereby vascular remodeling.
The researchers note that more studies are needed to investigate this association. So it's something I'm sure we'll all be following.
Absolutely, yes.
Finally, let's talk about a new clinical consensus statement from ESC. It raises awareness about the multidirectional relationship between mental health and cardiovascular disease, and the idea that one increases the risk of the other, and that patients who experience both have much poorer long-term health outcomes. This is the first ESC clinical consensus statement on this topic. So why now?
Yeah, isn't that the right time to release a consensus statement on this issue? I mean, we're living in a very stressful world, and we've also learned by heart that poor mental health is a major contributing factor to cardiovascular disease, and people living with cardiovascular disease are also at greater risk of poor mental health. And patients experiencing both cardiovascular disease and a mental health condition have the worst health outcomes. And the ESC felt it is important to provide some guidance, although this is more of a consensus statement, because here, you know, randomized controlled trials are not very frequently conducted, but it provides a common sense on what we believe is important, that mental health and psychological risk factors become part of cardiovascular risk assessment for healthy individuals, and that, you know, we should consider and propose a cultural shift to treat the deadly combination of mental health condition and cardiovascular diseases. And for sure, this document also acknowledges the complex relationship between the two diseases and mentions that we need a better and integrated person-centered care that is tailored to individual circumstances and, of course, need more science to be conducted in this important field of medicine.
Right. The consensus statement recommends that systematic screening and support for mental health conditions should be normalized in cardiovascular care, and that those who are being treated for mental health conditions should be regularly assessed for cardiovascular disease risk. So, yeah, that does seem to represent a cultural shift, as the consensus statement says. All right. Thank you so much, Dr. Mahfoud. It was such a pleasure chatting with you today.
Thank you so much.
That's it for this episode of JAMA Medical News. I'm Jennifer Abbasi, Director of JAMA Medical News. This episode was produced by Daniel Morrow at the JAMA Network. To follow this and other JAMA Network podcasts, please visit us online at jamanetworkaudio.com. Thanks for listening, and join us again next time.
This content is protected by copyright by the American Medical Association with all rights reserved, including those for text and data mining, AI training, and similar technologies.